Okay, good evening, everyone, and thank you for joining us for our first back to school Zoom program for the 2021 year. We are so happy to see so many of our children and teachers, and yes, parents back in school today, and look forward to seeing many more in the coming couple of days. While we know the numbers are down for the COVID-19, we continue to pray for those who are still ill and share our condolences for those who have lost loved ones. We are excited to be planning many Zoom programs in the coming weeks, so please watch your emails for more details. They are wonderful opportunities to share as a community. Tonight, backed by very popular demand, Dr. Sarah Schlesinger Hirschfeld, joined by Dr. Jessica Hirsh Weiss, and moderated by the one and only Rabbi Chaim Steinmetz, for the doctor is back in to school, moving forward in the face of uncertainty. We are so privileged, as I said, to have an amazing panel tonight. We start with Dr. Sarah Hirschfeld. Dr. Sarah joins us from the Rockefeller Institute as a professor, as someone who is involved in research, has done so much outstanding work in the field of vaccines and other related HIV research that you've heard about over these Zooms. We are very privileged to have her. And once again, the most amazing part of having Dr. Hirschfeld, of course, is having her son, Jacob, who is a fourth grader. And we are so pleased that she is with us. Dr. Jessica Hirsh Weiss, who joins us as a clinical psychologist in private practice here in New York City. She treats adults with a varied range of of mental health issues. Dr. Hirsh Weiss has done Zooms as well with us before through KJ. She has really graced us tonight with all of her knowledge, and she too shares her two amazing, amazing children with us at Ramaz, and we are very proud to have them as our lead panelists. And to moderate the panel tonight, we have the one and only Rabbi Chaim Steinmetz, who, as the senior rabbi of KJ, inspires and leads us in so many ways. He has such a grasp and understanding of the information regarding the COVID-19. Again, we thank all of you for sharing the evening and remind you that at the bottom of your screens, there is a Q&A button, and you can use that button for the questions that you might have, and we will make every effort to address them at the conclusion of the presentations. If we're unable to get to them, as those of you who have experienced this in the past know, both Dr. Schlesinger Hirschfeld and Dr. Hirsh Weiss will be very happy to respond privately to the questions that you may have. So, Rabbi Steinmetz, thank you. Please.
I'm ready to take it away. So thank you, Kenny. I want to add my own sort of mini introduction. Aside from the fact that I have such admiration for both of our panelists, and just to make it easier on me, I'm going to call you by your first names, if that's okay. So Sarah and Jessica. But I just want to make a comment that has to do with the last 20 minutes that we were discussing. We were sitting offline discussing what we're going to be talking about tonight. And it gave me this insight that, you know, knowledge is power. There's something incredibly powerful about having knowledge, and being able to hear and to learn from both of you is something that's empowering for me. It made me feel better after just talking to both of you for 20 minutes. So it really is my honor to be here this evening. And I think for all of you that are on this Zoom tonight, this is something very powerful. And we've all sort of lost a sense of control and a sense of power, and hear this knowledge can really make us a lot stronger. So thank you both for being here. And I'm gonna, you know, go in order as we set things out. I really wanna begin and turn to Sarah, who has been following the news in terms of the science, in terms of medical developments, and ask her if she could give us an update. I think the last time we spoke was in April even. So from April till now, there's been a lot going on. If you could give us an update of where things are regarding the coronavirus.
Rabbi, thank you very much. I'm honored to be here. I'm just delighted to be back. And like everybody else, I'm tremendously anxious. I think we're all getting tired of this. And just because we're tired and we want it to be over doesn't mean it's over. And, you know, it's really, you know, 6 months in, I think we're all feeling it. With that said, I am tremendously optimistic about the amount of scientific and medical progress that has occurred in the last 6 months. I honestly think it's unparalleled in the history of human history that scientists and physicians have collaborated in the way that they have and have made so much progress on a single disease in such a short time. So the first thing that's wonderful for us is and this is perhaps the most important thing and the biggest difference between now and April. I was out in Central Park today. I had walked over to Lex, I walked by the school. The city looks pretty much like it usually does, except everybody's masked. I have many masks here, they're my props. And you know, people are moving around, people are talking, the traffic is going. And when I compare that to April, when I look out my window and there were no cars and no people, and it really felt like the end of the world, that's huge progress. And that progress is based on the fact that we in New York have been able to control the virus. We've been now over 30 days with infection rates of below 1%. That is the single most important variable in all the things that I'm going to discuss. It means, and that's of the people tested, and how you extrapolate that to the general population is a complicated calculation that's not really, it's not even accurate because it depends on who you're testing. But suffice it to say, it means that much, much less than 1% of people are infected. And that means when you're walking around, most of the people you're walking by aren't infected, as opposed to April when it was 1 in 4 or 1 in 5 in New York City. So that's the most important difference. With that said, I made notes here so I didn't forget. The first thing that I would like to mention is testing. In April, there wasn't enough testing to go around. And when we talked about testing, I was very ginger in discussing it because a lot of the tests that were being offered weren't even accurate. And I said, I think at that time, that it would be worked out, that we'd figure out how to get them accurate. And testing isn't perfect now. There is enough testing in New York, but the turnaround time isn't always quick enough, but the tests are accurate. You can rely on the result you get. The challenge with testing is the test only tells you about that moment. So if you get tested on Tuesday and you don't get the result till next Wednesday, all the things that happened in that week aren't captured. But there's much progress being made on the testing horizon. Many of you, anybody who's been tested or seen it, involves a big nasal swab up your nose, and frankly, it's unpleasant. There are now several tests available, including one that's been developed where I work at the Rockefeller, that use saliva. And the one at the Rockefeller is a home test. It's not done at home, but they send you a box, you spit into a little tube, you close the tube, you send it back to them FedEx, and then they evaluate it, and you get the result within 48 hours. So that tests like that, there's one with Rutgers and one with Yale. And the Yale data has been published, and in fact, those are more sensitive and more specific, and pick up people with higher viral loads who are the ones who are most infectious. So that's really good news. In terms of treatment, nobody knew what to do with all of the sick people who were coming into the hospital in March and April here. And if you recall, we were worried about having enough ventilators and enough personal protective wear, masks and stuff for everybody. Those problems have been virtually completely solved. Thank heavens. There are still people who are sick and there's still people dying, but my colleagues who are in clinical medicine have figured out how to take care of people better. There have been two treatments, both of them for sicker people, for people who are in what's called severe disease. One is called remdesivir, which is a drug from Gilead that was originally developed for hepatitis C and has now been repurposed. And that's been demonstrated to be moderately effective. It's being tested in other scenarios. The problem with remdesivir is it's very expensive and there's not enough of it to go around. The drug that's actually been demonstrated to be even better than that is called dexamethasone or steroids. And that's a cheap drug that's generally available almost everywhere in the world. And that actually has been shown to have more impact in people with severe disease. It dampens the cytokine storm. So that's a huge step forward. There are many other more incremental steps that have been, that are in the works. Hydroxychloroquine, which many people, including me, thought was very likely to be helpful, probably isn't helpful, or not in the ways that it's been given. There are some novel ways of using it that are still being tested, but that's been answered. And the thing that I'm most optimistic about in terms of treatment are monoclonal antibodies. So monoclonal antibodies take the response from somebody who's gotten better, excuse me one second, and has had a really good response, and then they're made synthetically as a drug. And so unlike convalescent serum, that works pretty well some of the time, but sometimes it works and sometimes it doesn't because you don't know what kind of response the person had. This is routinized and is made as a drug. Excuse me. So I'm very optimistic about those. I'm also optimistic about vaccines, but we're going to discuss that later. Because that's, as you know, I can talk about endlessly. You know, Rabbi, maybe let Jessica.
Yeah, I'm going to switch to Jessica. We'll give you a chance to catch your breath.
I'll come back with vaccines.
And vaccines are great. We're now that you see, that's, you always want to leave everybody with a little bit of suspense. And everybody is actually in the chat. There have been questions about vaccines. So Jessica, so I wanted to turn to you because, you know, when dealing with mental health, it's now 6 months into this crisis, and what have professionals, what have studies shown in terms of what they're seeing, how people are reacting, you know, how prevalent are certain issues of mental illness, and what would you say about what the studies are showing?
Yeah, I'm not going to sugarcoat it. Things are not great from a mental health perspective. I believe that depression rates have tripled since the start of all of this. Calls to suicide hotlines are up 900%. Now, anxiety, of course, has skyrocketed. Things have shifted, though. And when we talk about anxiety, things have shifted. In the beginning, people were really anxious about their health. They were really anxious about the economy. Certainly, the economy is still something that people are talking about, and health, of course, as well. But now things have shifted because our lifestyles have shifted. And as Sarah mentioned, you know, back in April, no one was going out, and now we're out, and there's another level of anxiety in terms of how do I navigate this new world where none of us know exactly what to do, and there's just a tremendous amount of uncertainty. Now, the good news is, from a mental health perspective, mental health is finally getting sort of the attention that it deserves. Now, when you ask someone, how are you doing? It's not just the usual, I'm good, I'm fine. People are really talking about how they're feeling. And that to me is great, because perhaps one of the silver linings of this pandemic, and I think probably later on we'll talk more about silver linings in general, but one of the silver linings is that people, hopefully there's not going to be as much stigma around mental health. And the other good news is that there is a lot that we can do as individuals and as a community to take care of our own mental health and also the mental health of our children. I know tonight is really about going back to school. And so perhaps we can focus on what we can do for our children as they're navigating their new world as of today for many of us. And so one of the things that I think is really, really important, and all of the studies have shown this to be true, validating our children's perspectives right now, validating their feelings. It's really easy as parents for us to just say, everything's gonna be okay, sweetie, and that's not helpful. You have to validate how is your child feeling. And so words you can use are, I understand, or that must be really hard. I get how you must be feeling. And so validate them, but that does not mean that you just leave it there. You can validate the feelings and then help them to shift their perspective. So I know Sarah and I were talking about this earlier this week, this concept of yes and. It's two really powerful words. You have to have words in between them, but it's this idea that yes, you can feel one way And you can also feel another way that might feel like they're mutually exclusive, but in fact, that's okay. You can hold both. And so it's something, if you're talking to your children, yes, I understand that this is gonna be a hard year for you, or at least for the next few months, things are gonna be really hard. And there might be some great opportunities to discover new things about yourself. Or maybe we can, you know, sort of navigate this really quirky school year and have some great stories to tell in the future. So that's one of the things that I'm really recommending to a lot of my clients when we talk about how to navigate this new world, is really validating those thoughts, those beliefs, and then helping your children to shift their perspective.
Right. I mean, the only thing is, if I could jump in for a half a second, is that I think the challenge is if the parent themselves are anxious and they're not able to sort of convey that feeling to their kids, it becomes much more difficult.
Absolutely. And so you have to take care of yourself first, really, right. Or simultaneously, but certainly if you yourself can work on your own anxiety and how you're dealing with uncertainty. And when it comes to uncertainty, it really is just about embracing it and really leaning into that uncertainty and recognizing that there are some things we cannot control. And that's true in life in general. I think that this virus has really put that into focus, but in general, whenever we walk outside, you could get hit by a car, there could be a terrorist attack, there are a million things that could happen, and yet we do those things. And also when it comes to uncertainty, sometimes that could be a positive thing. Some wonderful things can come from uncertainty, as I'm sure we have all experienced. So that idea of uncertainty is really important for all of us to try as best as we can to embrace it. So yes, I'm scared, and I am also able to manage those feelings.
Jessica, if I just might jump in, as an anxious person myself and the mother of several anxious people, I think one of the things that you mentioned when we were speaking in preparing for this that I found so helpful that you mentioned is the notion that we're not alone in feeling this way.
Yeah. Right?
That it is a normal response to feel anxious, and this is not free-floating anxiety for no reason.
I mean, right.
Nobody, that's what I've reassured my children, even the smartest scientists in the world have no idea what's gonna happen this fall.
And there can be something comforting about that. I know studies have shown when it comes to trauma, one of the great predictors of how traumatic an event is for an individual is, are they sharing it with others? And when you are sharing it with others, you're much less likely to develop symptoms of PTSD, for example. So yes, it's funny, my family and I, when we watch TV commercials and they all say, we're all in this together, we roll our eyes a little bit because it's become such a catchphrase, and yet it's true. We really right. are all in this together.
Right. There's a great Hebrew phrase for it, is Sarat Rabin Chatzi Nechama, that the trouble of many is actually half the consolation. And that's really, yeah, and if you realize you're not alone, and you realize that even though someone else might be laughing or this or that, that they're probably also grappling with this in some way or another. So then that makes it a much easier, it's much easier because then you don't feel weird or unusual, and you're able to feel, okay, you know, we're all in this, and now we've got to figure out how to do it.
Yeah, and you can verbalize it, and that's okay.
Yeah, and so it, in terms of you know, some of the other questions that, you know, I wanted to talk to you about is, you know, you mentioned how you talk to your children and how you sort of get them to reframe first. I mean, obviously to validate and reframe, but what about friends? What happens, you know, on several levels? What happens if you feel, you know, that your friend maybe isn't taking proper care of themselves? That they're either too anxious or they're too rash, and they're not being serious about what they're doing. How do you speak to your friends in a time where every conversation about this is so tense?
Yeah. The first step is really trying to understand where they might be coming from. And I was having a conversation with a friend about this. When you see someone that's not wearing a mask, for example, it's so easy to assume that they have negative intentions. When you really think about it, they probably don't have some nefarious plot to, you know, spread germs around. They're probably doing things or not doing things, because as you mentioned, Sarah, we're tired of this. All of us are tired of this. So the first step when you're talking to friends is really try to gain their perspective as much as possible. And to ask them, can we have an honest conversation about this? Either I'm concerned about you. I know we're all feeling this way. So again, validate that it's normal to feel this way. And yet I'm concerned because it seems like what you're experiencing might be getting in the way of either your ability to do your job, to your ability to parent your children. It's maybe affecting our relationship. And so just opening that up and having an honest conversation with them. I do think it's easier to do these days because, again, we're having more of these conversations.
Okay, so Sarah, I want to sort of shift back to you. Left us at a cliffhanger at vaccines.
Yeah.
And that's actually one of the things that are popping up in the chat is when do we get a vaccine? What's going on with vaccines? Tell us a little more about the vaccine.
Tremendous progress made with vaccines, frankly, unparalleled progress. And there are something like, there's a vaccine tracker. And again, you know, I've sent these articles and I'll send them at the end of this. I think there are 165 vaccine candidates. So right now, all of the vaccines are vaccine candidates, and that means they haven't been approved. Technically, China has approved vaccine, as has Russia, but we're not going to count them. But all of the ones in the sort of Western world are vaccine candidates because they haven't been approved. There are 165 in testing and 20 that have made it into human testing. And now three or four, I'm not sure, I just read one update, that have made it actually to phase two or three trials. And those are the trials where you actually get an efficacy signal and that can be used for licensure, which is amazing. What is even more amazing than that to me is that the vaccines have been made at risk. So two of the most promising vaccines have been made in the US at risk and one in the UK. And what that means is typically you do all the testing and then you decide to manufacture the vaccine. And because of the urgency of this, the vaccines have been manufactured at risk. And if they don't work, that means billions of dollars will have gone down the drain. But if they do work, it means the day we know they're efficacious, we'll have vaccine in hand to begin to distribute. It's not gonna be in a day. It's not gonna be, you know, the vaccine works and everybody gets it. Everything takes time. But the years of time, the year or so it takes to make it has been truncated. So two of the vaccines have been made, and actually the problem now that I've heard is there's a shortage of vials and rubber stoppers. So the vaccines exist. We don't know if they work well enough or if they're safe enough to give to people, but they exist in manufacturing facilities. Other vaccines are being tested and will have to then be manufactured. So there are going to be many vaccines, but I've seen in the chat, will we have a vaccine by winter? My strong belief, and I could be wrong, but I hope I'm not, is that we will have at least one, if not two vaccines by the winter, by the beginning of 2021. Now, will those be the ultimate vaccines that will end, you know, that we will all take the way we take a
flu?
Well, not the flu, because the flu is not such a great vaccine that changes every year. So let's say a tetanus shot, which is a pretty standard vaccine, probably not. Or the polio vaccine, that's even a better example. There are going to be multiple vaccines. And the first vaccine, the RNA vaccine, the Moderna vaccine, is very, very likely to be safe. It's likely to induce an immune response, but probably not as strong an immune response as some of the ones that are coming along. But that's okay, because as long as it's safe, even if it induces partial immunity, it will have a huge impact on the epidemic. And partial immunity may protect from what do you really need a vaccine to protect from? I think I've said this before, death and severe disease. You know, that's what the flu shot. I mean, if everybody knew that they were going to be better in 2 weeks, we would be back to normal. So all of the standards for an absolutely perfect vaccine are not what we're going to be applied here. there's going to be the same standard of safety. And that's what I think everybody has to understand, that the all of the leaders of the major vaccine companies have signed a pact now saying that they're not going to compromise on safety. I don't know if it's been signed yet, but I understand that the leaders of the regulatory agencies, the EMEA and the FDA, are signing a similar compact. And frankly, I know many of these people. They're not going to put out a vaccine that isn't safe and effective. But what is different is everybody has agreed the bar for licensure for a vaccine is typically 90% effective. And both the EMEA, which is the European Medicines Agency, and the FDA have agreed that if a vaccine for COVID is over 50% effective, that will be enough to deploy it if it's safe.
Sarah, does that mean that you would be taking it twice or more than once?
Absolutely. It means that, so, and this happened with the polio vaccine. So you're too young, and even I'm too young to remember, but polio was a scourge different from this, but equally dreadful. And the Salk vaccine, which was the first vaccine to be developed, and that's a whole long, complicated story, which I will refrain from telling, but I love to tell, because they made that the results of that trial came out, and there was no plan to make it. So it was almost a year and a half from the time that the trial results were released to the time the vaccine was available to the American public. And in every conversation that I've been part of or heard or read about, everybody says, we don't want that to happen with this. But the Salk vaccine was a good vaccine, but the Sabin vaccine, which came around a year and a half later, which was the drops, for those of you who took drops, was much better. And so many, many people got this, everybody who could got the Salk vaccine when it was available. And then when the Sabin vaccine came along, they got that too. So I think that's very likely to happen. Several of these vaccines that are being tested require two doses. So very likely people will need, as with some vaccines, we'll need two shots. I mean, the Holy Grail is a single shot that protects you forever. We're not going to have that. And we may never have that with this kind of organism, but we're certainly not going to have it in the near term. But we are going to have almost certainly a series of vaccines that will protect us more and more and protect from severe disease and death. One of the reasons, and I really want to make this point, because why is there so much mystery about when we'll know if it works? Because I think that there's so much mistrust, and because frankly, there's been a lot of bad messaging by many people, colleagues of mine who have, through no ill intent, but I think they haven't been so clear. These trials are all what are called event-driven trials. So that means half or two-thirds of the people enrolled in the trial get the vaccine, and half or one-third get a placebo. And then they go about their life, and they get and the events that are measured in these trials are how many people get infected with COVID. So if you're doing a vaccine trial, for instance, in Brazil, lots of people are getting infected. Brazil is a wonderful vaccine site because they're very good at doing clinical trials. They have a robust infrastructure. And at the moment, unfortunately, they have a very high infection rate. New York has many sites for vaccine trials. Some of you may be enrolled in them. There's one at NYU, there's one at Cornell, there's one at Columbia, and there are probably others that I don't know directly of. Well, there are not too many events in those places, fortunately. People aren't getting infected very rapidly. So as the epidemic or the pandemic decreases naturally or because of good public health intervention, it becomes harder to conduct a vaccine trial and it takes longer. The Ebola vaccine couldn't be registered because Ebola stopped. They were doing trials in the Congo and all of a sudden, Ebola is a mysterious disease and I won't digress, but those trials, the vaccine couldn't be licensed using that methodology. We should only be so fortunate that that happens with this, but that's why there's this uncertainty about when there'll be enough events to say it worked or didn't work.
I'm just going to jump in for a moment, Sarah, because there's a couple of questions about vaccines. Sure. So I want to just do two of them, and then maybe we can go on to masks and some other things.
Right, I was just going to say, and then I'd like to go on to the practical things that we can do today.
Right. While masks and risk reduction and harm reduction. And which is an interesting question is, can this virus mutate and will that affect the efficacy of the vaccine?
So that's a very good question, and it's one that we all worry about. And the answer is yes, but fortunately, probably not. Unlike influenza, which has its own special biology that causes it to mutate in a way that requires us to have a new vaccine every year, this is a pretty stable virus. There will be some amount of mutation, and you'll be reading articles in the newspaper all the time about this mutant and that mutant. But the proteins, the spike proteins against which the vaccines are target, they're quite stable, and the mutations don't seem to affect them. So eventually that may be the case, but fortunately, unlike flu and certainly unlike HIV, with, you know, I spent my life working on, that's not the case with this, the organism, fortunately. It's what's called a good vaccine target.
Hmm. And the second one is what about age groups? Are these vaccines going to be useful for every age group? Will there be certain age groups that maybe the vaccine won't work on or won't be recommended for?
So you're asking, that's a tremendously important problem with all vaccines. So as we age, our immune system becomes what's called senescent, which is a nice way to say, you know, gets old. And your immune system starts to become senescent at about the age of 2. And then there's another real dip at 14, and I think another one at 30 or so. And by the time you're my age, you're toast. It's very hard to make a new vaccine response, which is why there's a special flu vaccine for people over 65 that has what's called an adjuvant or a booster in it to make induce a better immune response, because it is hard to induce a new immune response as we get older. And as everybody probably knows, the people most at risk for COVID are older people. And so the vaccine is particularly important in that group. Very often in vaccine testing, the elderly are not the first group to receive the vaccine in testing, but these vaccines are being tested in older people to see if they induce the kind of immune response we think we need for protection, exactly for that reason. So these trials are actually pretty well designed to answer that question better than many other vaccine trials in the past, but it does remain an open question, and it remains one of the challenges. Pediatric groups are another group that are a challenge. These vaccines are not currently being tested in children, as far as I know. At least the major trials don't include children. But children will need to get the vaccines, so that's going to have to be expanded as well. Which brings me to another point that I want to make that we didn't know last time we spoke. And as many of you know, as older people suffer more from this, children seem to suffer less, fortunately. There was some thought, even in April, that children didn't get infected, that they were resistant. There were a whole bunch of mechanistic explanations for that. Well, they were wrong. Children get infected. And not only do children get infected, but children who are infected actually, it seems like, have a higher viral load or a higher viral copy number in their noses and throats. It's not clear why they don't get as sick. We're all grateful for it, and people are investigating that. But what that means is children who become infected can easily infect other members of their households. And that was not understood until very recently. So that's a really important thing for everybody to know, which is why children need to wear masks as well as adults, both to protect them from getting infected and to protect them from infecting others.
That's terrific. I mean, I know you have different types of masks that you want
to
discuss.
Shall I do my mask demonstration now?
Do your mask. It's always good to have show and tell. This is a school project.
I didn't bring anything about
that. Yeah. Oh my goodness. Well,
meta, you know, right?
Yeah.
So the thing that I really like to sort of say, and I've been saying this to everybody who'll listen, and so all of you are now subjected to this, you know, I'm optimistic about all of these things that are moving forward, but there are things we can do today and now. And these are the things that have brought down the infection rates to below 1% in New York, because people have been doing them. If we stop doing them, the virus will come right back. It's not gone. Don't make any mistake that it's gone. And look at what's going on in Israel and England and France, in Germany, in Spain and Italy. We're not any different. But my public health colleagues are calling the core four. And I love this, and I think it's great for kids. And I think for those teachers who are listening, I think it's a nice way to think of it. And the core four are the four things we can do to keep the curve down. And they are the wearing of masks, good hand washing or using alcohol-based hand sanitizer when you can't wash your hands. Hand washing when you can do it is better. Maintaining social distance, and there are questions about that, and I'm gonna address those subsequently. And the last one may be the most challenging as we get into the winter and we have all the winter viruses, and that is stay home if you're sick. If you feel the least bit sick, this is the year to stay in bed and have chicken soup. But mask wearing works, and there's all kinds of new data. And I'm gonna, you know, I always send the papers after. There's a great paper from a Starbucks in South Korea. So Seoul, in South Korea, they do a lot of mask wearing. And in the Starbucks where there was no real good ventilation. It was the second floor, no open windows. And ventilation is another thing that's become, we realize is super important. All of the people who worked there who were masked didn't get infected. There was an outbreak in the Starbucks. But the people who had their masks off because they were eating, drinking, or whatever, 60% of them became infected. So the good news in that is if you have your mask on, even in an artificially ventilated space with what must have been a pretty high level of coronavirus floating around, you don't get sick. Or if you do, you get very mildly ill. The masks seem to, it seems to be a dose effect so that the more virus you get, the sicker you get. So there are all different kinds of masks. And I just want to show, this is the sort of, and there've been all kinds of tests and you can see them online. This is the standard surgical mask. Can you, everybody see?
Yeah.
That one's actually quite good. It's not the best, but it's pretty comfortable and it's quite good. This is a three-layered fabric mask that my son picked out for, you know, like mask swag is good. If you can pick out a mask you're happy with, that's a great thing. And a three-layer fabric mask with dense cotton performs better than this. This, which I bought thinking it was amazing, has a ventilator valve. I'm only keeping this for demonstrations. Nobody's a respirator valve, it's called. Nobody's being allowed to wear this in my house. Can everybody see this little valve?
Yes.
This valve allows you to breathe out. So the good thing about masks is first and foremost, they protect you. That was a misstated public health message in the beginning, but they also protect other people. If you wear one of these, it doesn't protect other people because this is a valve that prevents the air from coming in, but allows you to breathe it out. So if you're the infected person, you're gonna be spewing virus out. So I think this is a bad one. The best
it
ones.
It's not acceptable if you're going to a public place. In other words, if you're coming to, just to make it clear, if you're coming to KJ, you can't wear a mask with that valve.
Right. And if you're coming to Ramaz, can't wear it either. They are more comfortable because you can breathe out better. But
yes. Right, but the point of wearing the masks, I mean, it's interesting. The first time we had services in June, and of course we're outdoors and we've got social distance. But we make everyone wear masks. And I said, look, I want you to look around the room. I want you to understand, you see all those people there, everybody else around the room, you're wearing your mask, not for you, but for them. And that's really the key message, is that what you're doing is you're taking your spot, your place in the community and supporting everyone else by wearing a mask.
Absolutely. The best masks are what are called N95 or KN95. And the difference between this, which is an N95, which was from my supply from before the pandemic, and this is a KN95, which are readily available now at pharmacies all over the Upper East Side, is this is inspected in a way that guarantees its filtration. And N95 means it filters out 95% of particles. This is not inspected in the same way. So they can't, it's not certified, but I think it works pretty well and I feel very comfortable with it. But the key feature that I want to mention, if you wear one of these, and these are all different and they fit differently and people have to figure out what fits them best, is with a mask, and I'm going to put this one over, this is one I particularly like, you can wear a face shield. And you sometimes see people walking around with these, they look a little odd. But these face shields work really well, and that's what's used in the hospital when people do procedures. And they probably work because they can protect the eyes. Some people, you see people wearing these with nothing else, that's not acceptable because you're breathing out from under them and you can get air in under them. But if you have a mask, if you're in a situation where you're worried, for instance, if you're visiting an elderly relative, or I've seen several elderly people in wheelchairs and they have both the mask and the face shield. What I didn't have here is just the bandana or the buff, which is the thing that you see runners wear. Those really don't work even close to as well as these. And they are not acceptable, I would assume, at KJ or Ramaz either.
Sarah, so, I do have a question. Someone asked, why do I need to wear a mask if I'm 6 feet away from
someone? Okay. That's a great question, and I get it all the time from my son. We're in the park, I'm 6 feet away from my friend, why do I have to keep my mask on? So there are several reasons. Probably if you're outside and you're really 6 feet away, you don't need it. That 6 feet is an arbitrary number, and it turns out when the analysis has been done, and this is not my area of expertise, this is like ventilation engineering or some, forgive me for not knowing the correct subdivision of engineering, but air moves in different ways. So if you're out of doors, there's actually a tremendously protective effect from being outdoors. And the rabbi will tell you that I have been militant about that, about services, that we have to keep them outside because outside is hugely protective. It's not entirely clear why, the wind, the light, I mean, people have various hypotheses, but they don't know. But inside is where the risk comes. So if you're inside, it's not at all clear, depending on the ventilation, that 6 feet is actually enough. And so I've had this discussion with several people. Also, if you have to pick a mask. That 6 feet number is quite arbitrary and again, depends on the ventilation. If you have windows, open the windows. If you have a door and a window, open the door and the window. Natural ventilation is better for sure. There are all kinds of filters, and there's the MERV 13 and the HEPA filters, and again, this is not my area, that I believe are very helpful. But if you're outside, it's really much, much safer. And probably, though transmission can occur outside, it's been documented, it's only been rarely documented. And if you're at a distance outside, it's really almost virtually unheard of. So, but the other reason to stay both 6 feet apart and wear a mask is this principle that the rabbi mentioned that I think is a really important public health principle to consider, and that's harm reduction. And what that means is that none of these interventions are perfect. So if you're wearing a mask, it's not a perfect preventive. If you encounter somebody with COVID, you'll get some virus will come to your nose and mouth. Most will be filtered out. But if you encounter that person and you're 6 feet apart and you have the mask on, you're probably not going to get enough to get sick. If you then wash your hands, you're not going to have it on your hands to touch your eyes and infect yourself that way. So it's a matter of layering these very dull, hard to maintain, frankly irritating practices one upon the other that we have to do to protect ourselves and our community.
I love it. There was an article in the Times, I think 2 weeks ago, and he referred to it as adding to the pile. What can we add to the pile?
Right. But that brings up another point that we had also discussed that I wanted to mention. And some of the articles have talked about sort of banking good behavior, you know, banking risk. Unfortunately, you can't bank risk. You can't, because there was an article in the Times that said, well, if your child is playing soccer, don't let them go to the party in the park because they've taken too much risk. Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, any event is an independent risk event. And so you can be super, super careful today. And then if you do something risky tomorrow, all of the care you made today, you know, all of the mask wearing, all of the distance, all of the hand washing isn't going to protect you from the wedding that you went to where you took off your mask and you danced and you drank. So unfortunately, you can't bank risk, but you do want to add to the pile of protection. And I think it's a wonderful way to think about it. And it's a good way to talk to our kids about it.
Right. I mean, it's also about, it's a numbers game. I mean, it's you want to keep the number as small as possible. And perhaps if you're willing to sort of take certain risks in some areas, it doesn't mean you should take risks in every area. And that's really how you sort of have to look at it. And you know, like we're trying to be extremely safe. But okay, if it can't be quite that safe, then you try to find something that's close to that level of safety.
And everybody has to make their own risk analysis. And you know, for instance, I have an 84-year-old mother who I go and visit and sit outside in her garden with. And so I feel that I have a particular responsibility if I want to do that. I have adult children who love to see her who have decided some weeks not to come visit her because they went to something, or one of my sons is in medical school, he did something in medical school that incurred a risk. They said, I can't see grandma this week. So I think that, you know, he's called and said, I don't want to disappoint you, but I can't come because I went to orientation. And I think that that's both wise, judicious, and the right thing to do at this point. And everybody has to understand that that's the thing to do. Another variable that I didn't mention is time. And this is another one where data has come out since April. And that is, you know, I walk to the park, and when people have been walking by me unmasked on the sidewalk for a while, I was like in an absolute panic and I didn't want to go out. It turns out it's very unlikely, even if somebody is infected, if you just walk by them, that they're going to infect you. For contact tracing, they use 15 minutes, which is again arbitrary, but it does mean all those runners who are running to the park without their masks, which I still don't think is right, are unlikely to get you sick.
That's what you're
saying. Let me turn for a second to Jessica. And I want to talk to a word that most of us really don't feel comfortable sharing with others, and that is the word no. As Sarah mentioned, everybody's going to make somewhat of a personal risk assessment. Clearly, I mean, look, I think you need to reduce risk. Making your own personal risk assessment doesn't mean do whatever you want because it's your own choice. But people do have varying feelings about how much risk they're willing to take into their lives. And there are people who won't leave their houses, and then there are people who will go for a walk in the park, and then there are people who go for a walk in a park with their friend, and then there will be people who will sit outside and dine with their friends. How do we negotiate and negotiate without sort of, again, getting into trouble with each other when you need to say no to other people? And let's talk about our own kids, particularly because they will see other kids in their class, and so can do this. So I don't know if you want to start with negotiating with your peers and your friends or negotiating with your children, but how do we negotiate the word no? When in having these difficult discussions?
Absolutely. It's tough. It is. I'll start with that. It is really tough, and this is all new terrain for us. Saying no really comes down to assertiveness, being assertive. And it's important to distinguish assertiveness from aggressive. When you're assertive, it does not mean you're aggressive. And one really good tip for being assertive is to use what we call I statements. And this, by the way, you can use with your partners, with your spouses. When you want...
I'm going to win a couple of arguments tonight, I think.
Yeah, take some notes. Hopefully everyone's taking notes.
I don't know if Lisa's watching. Okay.
Hopefully she'll appreciate this. When you disagree with someone or when you want to have some kind of boundary with somebody, it's very easy to just label their behavior. And that's not helpful. It's not helpful to say, you asked me, I don't know, let's say you said, come over for Shabbos, we're gonna have 10 families, we're just sick and tired of this, it's gonna be beautiful, it's cold out, so we're just gonna be inside. So it's very easy for me to just say, you're being irresponsible, and to label that behavior. And instead, I would say something like, there is nothing I would love to do more than to come over for dinner. You know I miss that. It's been months. I would love to. And yet, because of what's going on, because I'm trying to protect my family, because now, especially that my kids are in school, I'm trying to protect our larger community, I don't feel comfortable with that. So I'm putting it on me. I don't feel comfortable with that. Why don't we find another way that we can spend time together, either virtually or we can go for a walk outside, so you present some kind of alternative behavior. Now, if what they're recommending really feels like, not only do you personally not feel comfortable with it, but you don't feel comfortable that they're doing it, then you can encourage them to sort of look within themselves, given that we're trying as a community, and when I say community, I mean the Ramaz KJ community, but even the larger community of New York and even of the world, to encourage them to really look at whether or not that is the best behavior at this point. And these are hard conversations. I've had them myself. They're not easy to have, and yet it's so, so necessary.
But in other words, it's essentially speaking to the other person, but not making them feel defensive and attacked.
Yeah, and not
really talking about where you are and what you're comfortable with. And that's why you don't feel comfortable participating, which is really wonderful. But now let's talk about another population for whom that doesn't always work. And that's your children. Yeah. And your kid comes home and says, my peers are doing X, they're doing Y, my best friend is doing this, and I want to go with my best friend to do whatever activity they're doing, and you're not comfortable with it.
Yeah.
How do you negotiate that conversation?
First thing, going back to what I said earlier, validate that this is hard for them. That's a really tough situation that you're in. Let them feel heard with respect to that. And then you can say, as a family, we have determined that what's going to keep us safe, and Sarah, to your point, everyone's in a different situation in terms of what kinds of risks they feel comfortable with given their family members and whatnot. But as a family, this is what we've determined. And I think it really depends on the age of your child. For some children, you can just say, this is non-negotiable. This is what we're doing. Because
but if when you have 11, 12, 13, it's a different type of conversation.
Absolutely, absolutely. And so, and then you can sort of encourage, or you can, yeah, you can encourage them or teach them how to then say no to their friends, which is a similar thing. You can say to your friends, as a family, we're not doing that. Can we find something else that we can do together? It's funny, my friends and I are joking that we used to hate video games. And now during this, we're sort of loving it because at least the kids can virtually play with each other.
You buy all the electronics you can. That's it. Go to the store.
I'm just going to say, Jacob is on a Zoom group with some of his classmates and they play a variety of video games together and they talk. They have it all set up.
You can talk on the game. It's actually very good.
It's wonderful. And it's real social interaction and it's organic. It's not arranged by me. They do it themselves. And I hear the Zoom ring and nothing makes me happier.
I mean,
I never dreamed I would be like,
yeah, of course. Now video games are great. Of course.
I'm like,
how did we not discover this until a half a year ago? so
that's when we no longer need the video games.
Then they'll say, Ma, didn't you say this was great? Like, didn't you say this is a good thing?
Help them to come up with an alternative. What else can we do?
Right. And I mean, there are obviously social elements also. I mean, a kid feeling neglected and feeling left out because they can't do stuff. It is a complex situation. And I'm sure that if parents have particular questions, they can probably reach out to you if you're okay with that. The second question I had for you now, and then I want to sort of shift back to good news and to Sarah, is, you know, the kids that are at home Zooming, how do you sort of give them that extra support? Because maybe they're feeling left out, maybe they're feeling cut off. How do you give them that sense of socialization, the sense of belonging? They may feel boredom as well. What can you do for kids that are home and Zooming?
First of all, praise them. Praise their efforts, what they're doing to protect, again, your family and community. A lot of us, I think we were talking about this before, a lot of our children really want to feel like their actions can have direct effect on other people. And the truth is, there's not many times that's really the case. And here is an opportunity for them, the things that they're doing. So Sarah, I know you mentioned that your son is the only child in his class right now that's doing this virtually. I would just praise him for what he's doing and validate that it must be hard in many ways, but oh my goodness, you're doing an incredible job. And then I would have a lot of communication with teachers and parents of the other children. How can you include my child so that they really feel a part of this class and of this community? And then with parents, if you feel comfortable, for example, meeting up in the park, making that a priority while the weather is still nice, making sure that those play dates happen, get those video games, get those Zoom calls, whatever it takes for that child to feel like they're part of this, despite the fact that they have to stay home, at least for right now. And that's the key, is that we take it one step at a time.
And if I could just jump in and say that for those who are parents of the other kids in the class, it's a really nice thing to tell your kid to call the one who's at home Zooming. This is, you know, we're always looking for opportunities to teach lessons of Menschlichkeit. And that's the ultimate lesson of Menschlichkeit. If your kids have friends in their class that are at home and doing Zoom instruction, have your kids give them a call. Encourage your kids to reach out to them and teach them at a young age what it means really to be a mensch and to be a friend. So one more, Jessica, I have one more follow. Oh, I know that was it. So now let's go to my favorite part of these interviews, which is, what's the good news? What can we look at? And Sarah, I'm going to get to you because I know your good news is going to be really, really intense. Jessica, tell me from a psychological standpoint, what's the good news so far?
The good news is actually what you just mentioned, that there's this incredible opportunity right now to teach our children such important lessons that maybe they wouldn't have learned. So maybe it's lessons of Menschlichkeit. Maybe it's lessons of how to deal with a remote world. They're probably gonna have to deal with that in the working world. Lessons of resilience, lessons of how to pivot. You know, we have a plan and then we have to pivot. These are incredible life lessons. I also joke with my friends that, you know, we finally, our kids know how to cook, they know how to clean, they know how to do laundry because they had to during quarantine. So what incredible lessons we're teaching our children. And I think that is a huge silver lining. Not to mention that we're all home a little bit more, we have family dinners together. So there is a lot that has come. I mean, I don't want to minimize the tragedy of death and illness that has occurred, but there has also been some beautiful things that have happened from this. So to me, those are all of the really good news from a mental health perspective.
And Sarah, what's the good news on the science and the medicine?
Well, the good news in my mind, and before I get to that, because that is always also, Rabbi, like you, my very favorite part, I just want to put one more plug in. I have my notes here. Everybody needs to get their flu shot, because we are coming into flu season, and even though we have COVID, flu is still going to come like it does every winter.
And when should we get that shot?
Well, that's a good question. So this is one of my slight differences with some of my colleagues. Because it's so important that everybody get it, there has been a move among some quarters, like at CVS, to say, come get it now in August or September. The typical advice is to get it in mid-September or the first week in October, because the flu vaccine is not a very good vaccine. There are a whole bunch of reasons for that, which they're very arcane. If anybody wants to know, I'm happy to share them. But the immunity only lasts about 6 months. The worst time for flu is typically February to March. So you don't want to get it too early, but you want to be sure to get it. So if your choice is to get it now or not to get it at all, now is better. But my recommendation would be mid-September to the first week in October. That's when we'll be getting ours. And that gives you enough time for the two to four weeks to develop immunity before the flu really comes in a big way. And it should, if it's a good year, should be durable through the season.
Okay, that's an important note that everyone should really pay attention to, is that, they are in CVS, and I was almost tempted to run out to CVS and get one done. And I am glad that I just heard you now, because I would have otherwise been running to CVS and
that's
getting
okay. It wouldn't be the worst thing, but wait a week or two. Might be.
Yeah, is it possible that the flu will not be as prevalent this year because we're doing so much social distancing and wearing masks?
All of the respiratory viruses are likely to be inhibited by the things that we're doing that inhibit COVID. So one hopes that we won't have a bad flu season because of that. But, you know, the flu, and the flu is a fascinating virus, and it has this weird thing. It goes through what's called antigenic shift and antigenic drift. So that means it reassorts its genes. It goes south when it's summer here to their winter and reassorts and then comes back. So hopefully we will not have such a bad flu season for exactly that reason, but we will still have flu. So in order to make the diagnosis simpler and frankly to prevent, I mean, people die of flu every year. You know, there are, I think there were 65,000 deaths from flu, not this past year, but 2 years ago, and maybe 40,000 the last year. It's a lot of deaths. So first of all, we always want to prevent those, but also to prevent them from people from occupying hospitals because we don't have a vaccine for COVID. I strongly recommend that everybody get their flu shot and get your kids. They're only required for children under five. It's this weird thing with the law in the state of New York, but please get your kids, you know, take them to their pediatrician, get their flu shots. It's also really important to maintain standard vaccinations. You know, we learned last year that measles is several orders of magnitude more communicable than COVID, and it spreads like wildfire. So make sure that your kids, if they need their routine vaccinations, that you don't miss those as well. So that was my in my little notes. I didn't want to miss that. What I'm optimistic about, Rabbi, is this thing being over. That, you know, this too shall pass. This will come to an end. We will look back on it as an anomalous time in all of our lives. When that will be, you know, nobody knows, but I am planning my Seder. I'm making big plans. And I, every year, many people who are on this know, we have a very large break fest. Last year, I think we had 110 people, and I'm sending out invitations to our 2021 break fest. Unfortunately, we're not gonna be together here. We're gonna have a very small break fest here, be like three of us. But next year, everybody's invited. And so I am getting my
audience out.
I'm putting it in my calendar right now, Sarah.
Okay, got it.
There we go. Let's see, when is it in 2021?
I have to look it up.
Yeah, I'll tell you. It's you know, because you're going to have now 500 people coming to your house. We're looking at
We will not be socially distancing.
So yes, when is Yom Kippur? It's beginning of October. No, it's actually the end of September next year also.
Really?
So I will be there. Not a problem.
I certainly hope so, Rabbi.
Yeah, I'm hungry already.
It's a really good breakfast, I have to say. It is one of the great pleasures of our family's life, frankly, and of my life. And frankly, thinking of missing it, I don't want to choke myself up, brings tears to my eyes. I can't do it this year. We can't do it this year. We can't be together. But next year, God willing, we will. And this is going to be over. And that's, you know, that's what gets me through. With that said, I circulated this thing that I found sort of inspiring, and I don't want to get maudlin, but it was on NPR about how in 1941, the typhus epidemic in the Warsaw ghetto was much less bad than it was in the rest of Warsaw, which was totally counterintuitive, right? People were in prison, they were in terrible quarters, they were being starved, they were 200 calories a day. I mean, it was just dreadful, dreadful conditions. And yet, because of the intervention of the organized public health, it was a hygiene committee or something. I'll send the article. The deaths and the morbidity, the mortality from typhus was much less in the ghetto than would have been predicted. And I find that so inspiring because, you know, we're really pretty comfortable here. I'm unhappy about, you know, a variety of things and not sending Jacob to school and all the things that we're all suffering from. But we're really in pretty good shape, except for those who've lost loved ones. And we can make it. A friend of mine likes to say, life is hard and I can do hard things. And we're doing a hard thing and it will be over. And we'll look back on it probably fondly in some ways. I mean, not in others for sure, but it will be over. And the vaccine, science is what's going to get us through. And I think I've mentioned this to you privately, Rabbi, but when you pray for the sick and when you pray for the healers, pray for the scientists too, because they are working night and day to end this. And sadly, this will likely not be the last, you know, I don't think we'll ever see anything quite like this in our lifetimes, but there are other viruses out there. And, you know, we need the scientific infrastructure to be able to work together to combat them. So that's what I'm optimistic about.
Amazing, amazing. I want to thank both of you. I see Kenny is coming on. And when I see his smiling face, I know that this means it's time to go. It's time to go. It's like when you're on TV news and you see like, okay, I have to leave now. You know,
so want it's this to end because I see how many people are staying on and I know no one wants this to end. And I will promise what I promised before, which is that we will continue to have these conversations, hopefully with all the optimism that Dr. Sarah just talked about, and that Jessica just talked about, and that Rabbi Steinmetz talked about, as it ends, we will have that opportunity. But in between, we will still bring ourselves together.
There's going to be plenty of time.
There will be time, and we will bring one another together. I want to especially, again, actually shout out and thank Sarah, you, and Jessica, and Rabbi Steinmetz. But I want to, in particular, thank Judah, Elliot, and Jacob for giving up their mommies tonight to this this really wonderful, wonderful.
Right. They'll be on the next panel together with us.
I'm playing video games with friends. Very happy.
On, because this I know is a very important and wonderful opportunity for you to hear some important information, and you know what this means to our community. And I want to encourage you next Wednesday night, please join us the 16th of September at 8 p.m. for God's Coronation in a Corona Year, a pre-Rosh Hashanah sermon program given by Rabbi Haskell Lookstein to inspire us and prepare us. Again, that's Wednesday night, the 16th at 8 p.m., God's Coronation in a Corona Year. We look forward to seeing you all then. We wish you a healthy, happy, and wonderful, wonderful week ahead and year to come. Thank you all for being on with us this evening.
Shana tova to everybody.
Shana tova.